good afternoon, and welcome to Moments of Hope with yours truly, Pastor Curtis Robert Grant. To the Zion Hope family, God bless you, and to all of you that have come to be a part of this presentation, God bless you. And for those of you that are going to join with us with the conference call, you may dial 515-606-5380, and then the access code is 636-090. And we'll pick up in Exodus chapter 33. And let's start with verse 17 and read down for a few of the following verses. And hopefully we'll be able to embrace these scriptures in a way that will be beneficial to us in our understanding. 17 says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found favor in my sight, and I know thee by name. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness to pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show my mercy on whom I will show my mercy. And he says, thou canst see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock, and it shall come to pass, while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my backsides, but my face shall not be seen." And so with that being said, I think it's interesting to see that Moses has now just come out of a frustrating situation where he come down from the mountain and have seen Israel worshiping idol gods. And I think that we have pointed out that Moses broke the Ten Commandments at the foot of the mountain because of his anger of his stiff-necked followers. And now Moses is in this emotional place where he goes into the temple and the tabernacle of God to commune with God. And in the conversation, God tells Moses that I got to remove myself from the people because they're stiff-necked. And if I don't, I'm going to consume them in a moment. And Moses, he pleads with God that God would not send Israel and him up without his presence amongst them. And so God said to Moses that, I'm going to send an angel before you, all right? Which God prompts Moses to plead with him not to send an angel, but for the presence of the Lord to be with him. And what you see here in this opening, verse 17, "And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken." And so Moses has convinced God to allow his presence to go up with Israel, all right? And so you find out that Moses has now allowed God to respond to him, and now Moses have his argument that if I found favor in your sight, if you know my name, then don't allow us to go up without your presence. And the Lord yields to the request of Moses and says to Moses, look, I'm going with you, all right? If that's what you need for me to further take you and this people to where they need to be, then I'll go with you. But what's interesting is that Moses, once he gets one request, he comes behind that request with another request. And that's what we find in 18. And he says, "I beseech thee, I beg of you, God, show me thy glory," all right, is the second request. And he said, and verse 19 says, "And he said, I will make my goodness," this is God talking to Moses, "pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy." And he says, "Thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live." And so Moses' request was to show me your glory. And God's response was, "I'll show you my goodness. Because if I show you my glory, it's going to put your life at a disadvantage. And so you've got to understand this about the power of God and the requests we make in prayer and the requests we make for our lives. God always responds to us based on what's going to benefit us. Because if he had responded to Moses' request to show his glory to Moses, Moses would have put himself at a disadvantage. And God says, look, I'm not going to show you my glory. But what I will show you is my goodness. And so the point I'm trying to make is that when God does not respond to your request according to what you requested, you've got to trust that the reason that he didn't respond to your request the way you wanted him to respond was simply because it was not going to work for your benefit. It was not going to work out that it was going to help your life, because some things you ask for, you ain't ready for. And sometimes God has to respond to you differently than your request, because if he responds to your request, it's going to put your life in jeopardy. And so you got to understand the power of what God is doing here, because he says to Moses, not my glory, my goodness. You see, he wants to see his glory. God says, no, I can't show you my glory, because if I show you my glory, you ain't going to live to see it. All right? You ain't going to live to enjoy what you saw. He said, but what I will do is I'll show you my goodness. I'll let my goodness pass before you. And God, how many times have God allowed his goodness to go before us? I think we all ought to be shouting about that, because God, in his infinite wisdom, is always in the posture of just being good. And that's why that phrase come out, God is good all the time God is good, because you can't find a time when he's bad. Even when we think he's bad, it's not God being bad, it's just how we see it. You understand what I'm saying? Because everything that God does, he does good, all right? And we have to learn to change our mentality, the way we look at life, because if Paul says all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord, then guess what? Everything we go through, all right, may not be good or may not feel good, but it is good because it's working for a purpose. Do you follow the power of what I'm saying? And so God says to Moses, I'm not going to show you my glory. What I'm going to show you is my goodness. And every one of us that's a believer, matter of fact, let's strike that. Every person that's on the face of this earth, every human person have seen the goodness of God go before him. God has been good to us in spite of what we've done, in spite of what we said, despite of the lack of commitment, despite of all of the stuff we've done. God has still woke us up in the morning. And so, and how many know that if the scripture says the wages of sin is death, then none of us should have woke up. And so for us to wake up is actually God allowing his goodness to pass before us, because he could call judgment on us at any time. And when God calls judgment, he'll be right in his judgment, because we've all sinned and fall short of his glory. All right. And so God says, no, I'm not going to show you my glory, but what I will show you is my goodness. And I thank God that he keeps showing me his goodness over and over and over and over again. Because the more he shows me his goodness, the more I realize just how good God is. And so with that being said, I've got to begin to understand that when God don't give me what I request, it's only because it ain't going to benefit me if he give it to me. And so I praise God for what I call unanswered prayers or unanswered requests. Because at the end of the day, God knows that if I give you what you ask for, it's going to put your life at a disadvantage. And I'm not trying to put your life at a disadvantage, because I'm trying to mature you and to make you what I created you to be. So therefore, I ain't going to give you glory. I'm going to give you goodness. And so I bless God for his wisdom. And we, on this other end, have to respect the heart of God enough that when God does something differently than we request, we've got to trust the heart of God enough to say, well, it was better for me to get this than to get what I request for. Okay? Because we don't know a whole lot of stuff. And God, as a father, has to give us stuff that we don't want because we don't recognize what we really need. And so at the end of the day, I thank God for his wisdom and how he uses it to help us. And so God does not give Moses his glory. I'm trying not to do that. I'm trying not to let the preacher come up in me. But he gives him his goodness. And I thank God for his goodness. And God comes behind and says, listen, I'm going to proclaim my name, all right? Jehovah, the self-existing one. The one that sits high and look low. The one that keeps on blessing you in spite of yourself. I'm talking about, I'm going to declare my name. Because the whole thing in a nutshell is that the goodness of the Lord is displayed in our life, that we might declare the goodness of the Lord in the world in which we live, because God is declaring his name through the vessels that he's chosen. All right? And so we've got to be good displays of the goodness of God, and we ain't got to try to make nobody think God is good, because at the end of the day, God is good whether they think it or not. All right? And we just got to go ahead and live our best lives so that when we stand up and make this presentation, you know what I'm saying? I may not have all of the material stuff you got, but baby, I got stuff that you wish you had, like a peace of mind. I got some love. I got some peace. I got some long suffering. I got some faith in God. I got healing when I need it. You see what I'm saying? I got everything I need. All right? And I may not have everything I want, but I'm satisfied because whatever God provides for me is exactly what I need. And so at the end of the day, I want you to see that. And so he says, look, I'll show you, I'll be gracious to them that I'll be gracious, and I'll show mercy on them who I show mercy. Because God is sovereign. He does what he wants to do when he wants to do it. And we have to be open to what God wants to do. All right? Because there are times in our lives where we are baffled about what God does, all right? And we see somebody who lived wicked all their life, all right? And they just did crazy things, and they hurt you, they did a, and then all of a sudden, God saves the individual. And we have a problem, just like Jonah. Jonah had an issue with the people he was preaching to, all right? And so he had a problem with Nineveh. And so Jonah didn't want to go preach because he knew that if he preached, God was going to forgive him, all right? Because Nineveh was a cruel nation, all right? And they had done some cruel things, and Jonah didn't think that Nineveh deserved the goodness of the Lord. And how many times have we have had that same mentality, that certain people don't deserve God's mercy because of what they've done? Well, baby, you better be careful, because what they've done ain't no worse than what you've done. And we got to stop looking at other people being the judge and let God do his job. But we got to do what God told us to do. And that is to love ye one another, period. All right? And so Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh and preach because he knew that if he preached, God was going to forgive him. And so he thought he could hold up the plan of God, all right, by not going. And God said, oh, you're going to try to do that on me. You're going to drop it like that. He said, okay, I got something for you. I got a fish waiting for you. All right? And in this fish, this fish, the Bible called him a fish, he put him in hell for 3 days. All right? And God literally had to put Jonah in a situation where he was suffering so intense that he had to change Jonah's mind. And the Bible said that when Jonah finally got out the fish, it only took him a couple of days to get to Nineveh and preach, and Nineveh got saved. The point I'm trying to get to you is this, is that we got to stop trying to control God and let God control us. If God want to be good to somebody who's been wicked, let him be good. Because guess what? What God does for somebody else does not hinder what he done for me. Because the truth of it is that I was just as wicked as somebody else, but God showed me his goodness and his grace, and I am where I am today because God chose to show me his goodness. He chose to show me his mercy, and I'm glad about it. Okay? And so let us stop being judges against other folks of God blessing somebody else simply because we don't think they deserve it. All right? Well, let's be honest. We didn't deserve it either, but he gave it to me. I feel like I want to preach, but I'm trying not to do it. Anyway, let me go on. And so the Bible says in verse 20, and he said, thou cannot see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. But the Lord said, watch this, behold, there is a place by me. All right? And thou shalt stand upon the rock. Now, this rock that Moses is standing on, if I were to just spiritualize it for a minute, this rock is Jesus. Because if God says it's by me, Now, understand this. It's by me. You look at the omnipresence of God. That means God is everywhere. So everything is by God. All right? And so you can look at it from that physical perspective. But when you look at spiritual matters, the only person that's by God is Jesus. Because Jesus is on the right hand of God. You understand what I'm saying? And so he says, now stand on the rock. All right? Which actually says to me through the message in the spiritual realm is that when you deal with God, you need to stand on Jesus. You need to stand on the word of God because it's the word of God that keeps you stable while God deals with you accordingly. You see what I'm saying? Because it is the power of standing on the word, standing on Jesus Christ, standing on a solid foundation so that we don't get swept away by the situations that the life has to offer. You follow what I'm saying? And then he says, look, stand by me. Watch this. And watch, he says, and it shall come to pass that while my glory passeth by, or my goodness, that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock. I'm going to hide you in the rock that you're standing on. You do know every child of God is hid in Jesus. That's the only reason I got righteousness, is because God hid me in Christ. Y'all ain't trying to hear me. When God look at me, he don't see me, he see his son. Because if he saw me, he'd have to kill me. All right? The only reason I got life today is because God hid me in the cleft of the rock. Jesus, I feel like preaching. I'm trying not to holler in this place. Type it in your computer and send up God some love signals. Because God hid us all in the cleft of the rock. He put us in Jesus so that nothing on the outside would be able to destroy us. Watch this. Not only did he hide us in the cleft of the rock, but then he put his hand over the cleft of the rock to make sure that we are secure, that we don't have no exposure to death. Because if I let my hand off this rock and you see my glory, then you're going to die in the rock. So he puts his hands over the rock so that you don't get exposed to death. Tell the neighbor, say, I'm secured in God. Because when God put me in Christ and put his hands on it, he sealed it so that I wouldn't have to ever worry about death no more. My grandmama used to say it like this. I died once, I ain't got to die no more. Praise God. Because God puts Moses in the cleft of the rock and he puts his hands on it and he passes by. And the Bible says, and I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. I don't know exactly what Moses seen. God, in his infinite wisdom, manifested some kind of image that God would have the power to present so that when he took his hand off, his glory has passed by the place where Moses was. And when Moses peeped outside of the cleft of the rock, he was able to see the after manifestation of God's glory. And the Bible called it God's back. Because if Moses lived, we know he didn't see his face. So the only other part he could have possibly saw and lived was probably his back. I don't know why Moses wrote it the way he wrote it, but God showed him something. It might have been a theophanies. I don't know. The Bible doesn't tell me. But whatever it is, Moses saw it. And how many know that when you're frustrated as a leader and when you're frustrated as a believer, God will show you what you need to see in order to keep you encouraged on the journey, so that you don't give up before your time of revelation and manifestation, all right? And so I got to quit because my time run out, but I was having a lot of fun because saints, ain't nothing like the Bible, ain't nothing like the scriptures, all right? And saints, we are going astray because we don't stay close to God. And saints, let me be honest with you, even those of us that stay close to God will still recognize it's still a struggle. It's just not much as much of a struggle. But for those of us who ain't even tried, man, your life can be unstable. And God is saying, listen, if you're going to have any kind of stability in your life, you're going to have some stability in the Word of God, because it is the truth that shall set you free. God bless you and God keep you. I got to close right here. But I want to open the doors of the church. If you hear the Lord today and you want to see God's goodness, amen, you've seen it. But because, you know, you wasn't really looking for it, you didn't even know what you were seeing when God showed it to you. But when God hides you in the cleft of the rock, then you'll know exactly what you're looking at, and you'll be grateful for, well, I'm praying that you learn to be grateful for what God shows you. Because at the end of the day, God does not have to be good to us, because he has every right to destroy us because of the sin that we carry. And so, if you want to give your life to the Lord, today is a good day. You can inbox us your name and your phone number, and we'll try to get back with you as soon as possible. And then don't forget, every day at 1 o'clock, we are in prayer. God, pray, 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 please pray for our country, our president, and for everything that God places on your heart, because a family that prays together stays together. God bless you and keep you as our prayer. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this presentation today. Oh God, I pray that you would season the words that proceeded out of my mouth with your wisdom, that we might be able to help someone on the other end of this presentation. God, I pray that you speak to us in such a manner that these scriptures will make sense to us and begin to show us the very privileges that you have given to us because of your goodness. Cover now our lives with your blood and with your hand, that we might continue to move forward and mature in the spirit, that you be glorified in our lives. Touch us now in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God.